short this recording.
Yeah.
So when it's done, I should.
You'll press stop.
Stop.
Yeah.
And do you have other things that you're going to pull?
Many answers.
But it's going to be short.
I'll be busy this week. I won't be able to do it this week.
Yeah, so then it's right down there.
So it's recording.
Yeah, it's recording. And we can all edit around.
Okay, so I'm different.
Yeah.
Just watch this.
Yeah, so when you just want to stop recording, okay, maximize.
And actually, that's why I should just.
It will say.
It should be the C and U folder.
Yeah.
And then I can find the user of the comp. And then I can find today's class.
Yep.
But I have to.
What's that?
I believe that.
Yeah.
And then here is recording now.
Yeah.
Here is the.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
You're good.
Okay, so I'm recording the class. Be careful what you say. It won't take your pictures, but it will catch your words. Any questions? Any questions for the stop training game?
No.
I think it's still just in a couple days. Till the 7th. Till the 9th. Till 2 days.
Welcome to Jackson University.
Okay, so Joe is no problem. Hudson. Possible, Taylor, we all have chances. Not so far.
We should do the first 10.
Yeah.
First 10, yeah. See, that question is not extremely hard.
I didn't.
I think a lot of you guys just fail or pass.
Yeah, exactly. So let's work out a deal.
Let's work out a deal.
I'll just do my best.
How much?
How much do you need, Todd? I'm here to make a deal.
How about if we make $100,000?
Really? You know, we should offer Joe a
deal or no deal.
I agree.
How about this? Anyone who finishes above you in the game.
So, what's your name?
I'm nine. Two above you.
Okay. That's fine. But you still have 2 days.
That's fine. So, like,
I'll start cheating.
No!
Now, I have to do that.
So what chapter's now? Chapter 9?
After midterm, so it's chapter after midterm, after nine. Chapter 8. So it's chapter 9, 10, 14, and 13, and 2 and 3. 23 are like actual credit cards.
9.
Actual credit cards.
10.
Which one are actual credit?
13 and 14.
The financial statement analysis.
The chapters.
See, this is a quick comment. So this is the exam questions. So next class, we will work something, just financial statement analysis, cash flows. We'll work on something similar to this. And for this question, I don't know if you have tried or not, but they give you the information for 2 years. So you should start with $70. And then when you finish all your calculations, you should get $75 by the end of the year. In that year, the cash has increased by $5. So this is like your old calculation should be start from there. Start with $70 and end up with $75. And how where does the money comes from? Where did the cash go? Where did it come from? So this is, and then you will finish your cash flow statement. And this is actually polling questions. So this one is hard because you have to get exactly 70 and 75. You have to get $75 by the end of the year. So sometimes you make some tiny mistakes and you won't get this number, and that means something's wrong. So it's a little hard. Okay, so 30, question number 31. So it should be not L, it should be APC.
What question do you
need? ALB.
ALB, ALB, okay. So it should be A, and the next one is L, and the 32 should be B. I think 32 should be B. ALB. Okay, so
31 is what? A, L.
Change 32. Company L to company B. So, yeah. Question number 5, right? What's the problem with question number 5? So you didn't see the answer?
It doesn't come up the exact one.
Okay. Well, let me go home and figure that out again.
Yeah, I've tried multiple tools and I keep getting the same answer, but that answer is not there. I'm just wondering if I'm guessing something.
Yeah, well, no, I think you were right. Because I think I changed the question because I remember the test bug question doesn't have the cash flow for year 4. So it only has 3 years cash flow. That's why. But I'll add the $10 if you have. I'll just come up with the answers. I'll just make some changes for the answers, for the options. So it shouldn't be much of a problem, just lots of calculations take some time. So, any other questions?
Can you talk a little bit about calculating the weight of debt and equity? Because when we did that in class, I think they were just given as 50% of the
Well, just think about it's a big pie. For example, you have $1 million. This is a big pie of $1 million. If you have 0.3 million in A, so the weight and 0.4, for example, 0.5 million in B, and 0.2 million in C. So you got total $1 million from you allocated among A, B, and C, 3 stocks. So what's the percentage? So it should be 30%. This is A, right? So 50% should be B, 20% should be C. So that's the way. Just the percentage you invested in each stock. So that's what I'm asking to do. But the question I think is just giving you, for example, not $0.3 million, but give you, for example, 1,000 shares. 1,000 shares, each one is like $300. per share. So you need to figure out the total values of.
And that would be like the cost of the value of the equity.
The value of the equity, yeah, for stock A.
For and value of debt, that would be like the price of the bond.
Yeah, should be the long term bond. I know the question this way, right?
Yes.
Yeah. See, this one, what I want you to do is see the long term bond. The company will raise capital from bond market or equity market. So this is the dollar amount. This is the book values for the bond. So you just use this number. For the equity, you use this number. So like total will be $70 million. $40 million is from bond. $30 million is
wildly overthinking this then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because this is the capital raise from the market. And then this recurring earning is just like profit accumulated.
Right.
This is a community profit. So all the others just like borrowing, like accounts payable is just borrowing from banks. So now like raised from the capital.
What numbers that
match? Yeah.
35, 36.
Yeah, so last
year, I guess 36 was what it took.
Yeah, so see the way I can just tell you here, the weight of that should be the total is 70 million. So for this question, just like the pie is $70 million. But the debt is $40 million and equity is $30 million. So the percentage would be how much?
So 57 and 40.
Yeah, something, yeah. So yeah. This is those numbers. Okay, perfect. Thank you. You're almost dead.
How many? 40?
And you just want a pass and fail, right?
No.
You want A and B, yeah. Well, to work on the
because it was a lower beta.
Beta
is chapter 8. The beta
is chapter 13. We are going to study what's beta. Now.
Okay.
Okay, so let's start. Chapter 13 is kind of hard because, you know, we always hear like high risk and high return, right? But a stock market is risky than bond, right? So why? We say like because there's uncertainty, because we cannot know what will happen. We got lots of reasons, but however, I want to ask you a question, specific question, like how much riskier is this one of the stock market than the bond market? Tell me the number. Give me a number. Say stock market is riskier, but how to measure the risk of stock market? You know, well, we know it's risky, but how to measure the risk? So you have to just tell me how much is it. And then because different stocks will have different risk levels, so it should come up with different returns. But why, how much is it? So you have to just be able just to do this kind of calculations to calculate the risk and also to calculate the returns using some kind of models to do that. But how to do that? For example, Walmart is riskier than the money you put into the bank because the money you put into the bank almost has no risk. First, what's risk here? When we're talking about stock market is risky, are we talking about, let's say, you want to make 20% return, but you only get 5% of return. Is that risk we're talking about? No, you lose money. Risk is just like losing money. So we're looking at the negative returns from like investing in the stock market. Yeah, so that's a risk. How to measure the risk? For example, Walmart. How to measure like the risk from like your investment in Walmart? Or how much money you can lose from Walmart?
Depends on how much you
can.
Well, percentage wise. What can you do? If you can figure out the percentage you can lose from your investment in Walmart, and you can figure out how risky it is. Yearly, but we're not going to do that calculations here because I'm just trying just to follow the textbook. So exam questions will be close to those examples we're doing here. Anyhow, yearly what we do, if I ask you how risky is Walmart as compared to Apple, for example, what you can answer is just like calculate the standard deviations of Walmart and calculate the standard deviations of Apple, and then which one will be higher? Walmart movies smaller than Apple's. That's why Apple is considered more risky and more volatile than Walmart. This is generally the way to do that. Just calculate the standard deviation using the stock return of Walmart for example, in the past 5 years. And then the standard deviation will tell you how risky it is. Why is that? Remember what standard deviation is?
Standard deviation.
Yeah, it's a bell curve. See, for example, Walmart return is around 5%. Say on average, it's 5%. This is its new mean here, right? So it should be the bell curve.
Bell curve.
Once we know the standard deviation, for example, this is one standard deviation.
Equals.
Okay, so you see, for example, standard deviation is 20%. So in that means this point could be 50%. That's what we mean here. So we're focusing on the negative return part. So you look at the standard deviation, you can tell how risky it is, or the percent, or how much money you can lose from your investment in Walmart. Say here's 0%. So this is the potential for you just to lose money from your investment in Walmart. As compared to this, to say for Apple, you probably will have like, for example, 10% of average return from Apple, but your spread could be wider because it's considered like more uncertainties for investment in Apple. So it's standard deviation. Could be higher, could be like 30%, for example. And then so your returns over here could be like negative 20%. You see your risk, for example, here is 0%. Your risk is just possibilities on this side, could be higher. So Apple is more risky because the standard deviation is higher. So it's more likely for you just to fall on this side and to lose money. So that's why, you know, when we're talking about Apple is risky, we compare standard deviation of Apple with Walmart. They say if you put the money into a bank, for example, you only get 2% in return. And this is the returns you get from the bank. But however, there's no deviation at all. You always get 2% no matter what. So the standard deviation would be zero. So this is safer, this is narrower for the spread, this is the widest one. So this is no risk at all. A little bit risky, but this is the most risky one. So that's what you do. You use standard deviation as a measure for risk, as a proxy for the risk. So this is why you can do that. But we are not going to do that because there's no exam questions like this.
Is it given by percentage wise or what's the unit of the
standard deviation is always like if you are calculating the standard deviation of the return. So standard deviation will be percentage also. This return is percentage.
It's percentage.
Yeah. But we are not going to do that. But anyhow, let's just focus on like the textbook. This is one way. Look at the past stock returns, calculate standard deviation, figure out the negative returns possibilities how much. The textbook starts from here. Okay, it's also individual stock, but given different, because finance is trying just to make predictions of the future. So given the predictions of what will happen in the economy, so these are the possibilities. So based on the information here, we can calculate like the expected return or how much you can get as the best expectation based on the number and also calculate standard deviation. Standard deviation here just also, because it's a spread, so you can use it for risk kind of measure. So can we do that? For this chapter, we just basically follow the questions here. Exam questions are similar to these questions. It's not so hard, but you have to do lots of the calculations, like the first one. So what do you think? So It could be the probability of recession. Yeah, well, the economy could be in a boom condition with 30% possibilities, or normal. This is 50% possibilities. And if it's a booming economy, the returns for C stock would be 15%, for T stock would be 25%. Okay, so we got two stocks here. Now, the first question is, what's the probability of recession in this case?
20%.
20%, yeah, it's no problem, right?
Okay, so
has to add up to
add a minus.
Add up to what? So 1 minus 0.5 minus 0.3 for 0.2 recession. Now, what's the expected returns of company C and company G stock? And how much is the standard deviation of the two? See, the equation is here. Expected return, T stands for probability, R stands for the return. So you just add up, you use probability multiplied by the return, add it up. That's your expected return. So this just said, we expect this kind of returns to occur. This is based on your estimations of the future. So you expect returns to be exact. And the variance is the standard deviation square of the standard deviations, right? The power of two, that's the variance. So the variance, this is the equation, probability multiplied by the return minus the average return, the power of two, you add it up into condition, and get the square root, and that will be your standard deviation. So these two equations.
So that's the formula?
I think you make that. There is a question like that. And you can see, I think there's a couple of homeworks. Anyhow, so yeah, let's just calculate the standard deviation and the expected returns of both C and T. And let's see how much is it. So the expected return, since we got three economic conditions, you just use probability multiplied by the return, add up the second condition, and we can use sum product in Excel to do that.
In Excel, remember, do you use product?
Sum product.
Sum.
Sum product. So what it is just like an array of probability and another array of return. Which one?
C. Probably not.
C is, you got the standard deviation also? Let me.
We're still on two?
Yeah. Return should equal to 0.3. Yeah, and 70 days. The equation is just probability multiplied by the return minus the expected return with the square power 2, and then you add it up. So it should be Q1 SQRT square root
plus
1 of probability of each. For the booming economy, this is probability.
Square root 0.3 times.
And then it's return 15% minus 99929. Remember how it's complicated that it just like it just repeated.
So you type that thing in Excel?
No, unfortunately, nothing is moving yet to this version.
So basically, you do that like a longhand?
Well, no, see the equation. And then we got the answer.
Yeah, so you can do this in Excel. You can plug this entire formula into Excel.
Yeah, yeah. So once I got this, I just want to show you. So in that question, just like that. Music. We can add some to her. It's not going to go
yet. Okay, so let me copy that.
I don't have to say goodbye for now.
Well, that, yes. And that's in, what is it?
Salam.
Masalama is goodbye, I think, isn't it?
No, for now, right?
Or salam.
Salam. Salam is hello. Salam.
Masalama is goodbye
in Arabic.
Oh, the office is
Persian.
Farsi.
Farsi, yeah.
So I know who's Farsi.
Yeah, my husband is from the U.S. That's why I only know that part.
I need to learn how to speak Farsi.
Because he speaks so soft. I don't know about Arabic language. Their language, he's talking to his mother, it's always so soft. Maybe so. Yeah. And how he's speaking in Farsi. Maybe it's not his father. I don't know. You have to hide that
image. That thing right there. It's square, right?
Oh, I forgot we were recording.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Anyhow, so I got 4.5. I don't think it's right though. It's not right. Yeah. Okay. I think something is wrong. I think so. I know. That's 4.5. I got 4.5. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I should be right. 4.5.
Percent 99%
4.5%
square plus 0.2 times. That's a long formula.
Well, see the equation? The equation is just add up for each economic condition. We got 3 here.
This time travel
right there. 3 times.
Professor, let's time. That's the flux capacity for me. Still going.
So there's the exam question. So the equation is in the website. The equation is.
So basically, the expected return is whatever the answer 9.9.
Yeah.
And then the standard deviation.
The expected return is just RI. So in our case, we got 3 conditions. Expected return. E stands for expected, R is return, E is probability.
compliant.
With the power of two. And then so, see, we're just extending the whole equation. Right? Am I right? So, yeah, we just I did nothing. But just like P1 multiplied by R1 minus the expected return. Here's P2, P3.
They can do that.
4.5%.
So can we do this, Professor? Like doing the longhand.
What does it mean, longhand?
I mean, like calculator. It's a calculator.
Well, calculator. This is the equation.
That's the equation.
Yeah. Right. So you have to be careful. So you got the answer.
So we type it in Excel.
You have to type the whole thing. Whereas, calculate this first, don't do the square root. Calculate the variance first. Probably see the variance, you have the square root. So, this is variance, calculate the variance, and then standard deviation. It equals to the square root of this number.
Just the equation for the variance.
So this is the so we're done, right? So now let's calculate the third question. Let's see how much is it. And meanwhile, I'll work on it too. And I sell the let's see. So this is the third question. So second part. So I need this number for my next question.
Third question, what is 6.4? What is the dollar stock price and dollar amount? How does it do it? How do those plug into these formulas?
If it's a dollar amount, you have to calculate the return first.
Okay.
Yeah, for example, it's $10, but now it's $15, so the return should be 50%. $5 gain off of $10 investment. So it would be $5 gain, dollar gain, 50% of the increase. 50% increase in value, so it's 50% increase. So it is a dollar amount. So one of the questions is a dollar amount. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you have to calculate which one?
17.
Yeah, see that you use those return number.
So the dollar amount doesn't necessarily make a big impact on
No, but see, in this case, you know, you have $25. You see, the stock is $25 now. It could be $35. Then that means it's 40% in return. $35 minus $25 is $10 gain.
Right.
Out of your $25 in investment, so it's 40% in return. So it could be like $25, so no return. Or it could be $20 because you lost $5. So you just use this return method.
Okay.
Because for this dollar amount,
or the first formula, or for the expected return formula, you just use the percentage?
Use the percentage.
So you don't use the stock price?
You don't need a stock price.
Okay.
You don't need the current stock price either. That's all you need.
Okay.
Yeah. See the variance, the hybrid, remember this is the variance is
the square, the three square root.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you get the square root, you get the separation.
Right. Okay.
That is the variance. Let's just do the variance. It's just tedious, but it's not that hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Standard deviation is 6.4, right?
6.4, yeah.
Based on the formula.
4.5.
Huh?
The previous one or this one?
The previous one. I'm still, yeah.
This one?
This one's 4.5.
I don't know, I'm not there yet.
Standard deviation, E, expected return, standard deviation. Variance is what?
This is just a low for variance. Right, 5.89%. Yeah. So, but the variance answer is here. So, yeah, and then the standard deviation is this number.
That's long. Thank you. standard deviation.
So, so you got the answer right for the exam questions, right? The three.
What's this bottom one calculation, ma'am? The standard deviation, that's the formula?
That's why it just
the bottom one.
This is
the variance.
This is the variance. You get the square root of the variance, that's standard deviation.
Okay, I see. Variance. Square root of the variance is the standard deviation. Square root, right? Oh, this thing got, I forgot to put square root.
So this is like you have a stop, and then you look at the return, and then you figure out its standard deviation. And have you ever asked? Well, I'm pretty sure you're wondering. Okay, so you got the average. On average, you get 6.4% of return with the spread of 5.89%. So what, right? And so what? So with those numbers, what can you tell after
you don't have a high risk of losing money?
You don't have it yet. Because you see, one standard deviation away from the mean, it's still positive. Still positive. But I won't go into any details here. But if you look at the prior semesters, I was teaching these different kind of ways. You see, because once you got the mean, you got the standard deviation, you can make predictions. You can make predictions, for example, like how much, I'll just show you just one very quick thing. For example, to lose money, or earn negative returns, your probability is how much? Once we know the means, and we know the standard deviation, we can just make predictions like that. Just assume this normal distribution. So how much is it? Very quickly, we can do calculations. 6.4, 5.9, 8.9%. See, this is the mean, and this is the standard deviation. But this is not required. Yeah. I'll just show you probabilities to lose money. How to do that? We can just use like normal distributions features over here. So, we can use the norm distribution. It's all your thing. So the x, we want it to be 0%. We want the mean is 6.4%. The deviation is 5.889%. And then, So probability to lose money is 13.857%. So that's what you do. So once you got the mean, you got the standard deviation, you can make predictions like that. The chances to lose money is 13.86%. So you can make predictions like that. Using normal distribution, but this is not required. Normal distribution is when we're using the bell curve. So we're just calculating the cumulative normal distribution function. And then calculating what's the area on the left side of 0% on the normal distribution. So that's what we're doing, using those numbers. That makes sense? Yeah, that's what we do is, once we know the mean and we know this information, we can make predictions of what will happen to your investment. You say following some kind of context, moment distribution. Okay.
Will you show the standard deviation formula all the time?
Okay, so it's here.
What do you do when a percentage is negative?
You won't get a negative standard deviation.
No, I mean, like, what do you do if one of the columns is negative on the top? You just put negative in it?
See, this is a negative. Negative minus whatever it is, positive or negative, just use that number minus the mean. The mean can be negative too. For example, you got negative. But if it's negative, you still minus the mean. The mean will be negative. So whatever it is, you just minus, use the return minus the mean. The mean could be positive, could be negative. You just follow the equation. See the equation for this kind of question, and there's a couple questions here. The equation for this kind of questions is here. Follow the equation. See, we got 1, 2, 3 scenarios here, so n equals to 3. So we got P1, R1, plus P2, R2, plus P3, R3. So here the same thing. So P1 multiplied by R1 minus the mean power to 2, and then plus P2. Multiplied by that, repeated 3 times. This is just an equation. No, Joe? Tony, sorry. Joe is your
set. I'm still trying to digest it.
Yeah.
You said P2. Okay, so the following would be P2 because that's P1.
P1 multiplied by R1 minus and now this is. The second one, see,
you distribute
n
that.
Equals to 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, yeah.
Plus P2 multiplied by R2 minus the B. And then plus P3 multiplied by R3 minus
distribution. Yeah. Distribute P1.
So this is called variance.
Variance.
And take the square root, that's the equation.
I need to study this.
All right, so. And the second part of this, so this is individual, but now portfolio. So we don't hold individual stock. So what will happen to if you have a portfolio? For example, you have S&P 500 index. You bought the index. So how many stocks in your portfolio? 500 stocks, right? So if it's 500 stocks. For example, there's a hurricane coming hitting Jacksonville. It doesn't affect any other stocks in your portfolio, right? So because your Jacksonville related kind of stocks is just a small percentage of your portfolio. So it seems like hurricane Matthew don't have much impact to your portfolio, right? You don't see its value change too much because you have a hurricane Matthew, right? So it's different. But if you have only one stock, like you have Fidelity only, and Hurricane Matthew hit Jacksonville, and then so you see the stock price of Fidelity, which is went south. So in this case, because you're only having one stock, you lose a lot of money because of that. But if you have the portfolio, it will not be so significant, right? So it will not be so significant. So it's different. So it's different. Portfolios are different. So this is the better way. To investors, it's a better way. You buy portfolios instead of holding individual stocks. Because you don't know what will happen. Because we don't know, like, hurricane is coming. And so you bought the Jacksonville stocks, you're not anticipating anything like that. But it does happen. So if you have a portfolio, it won't bother. It won't be such a big problem anymore. So that's why you should have a portfolio. Okay, so portfolio is just like you can still maintain your high returns because if you have a portfolio, your stock portfolio's performance will be like average stock of all the stocks you have. which is average. You have portfolio, you have the average performance of each stock in your portfolio. Okay, so you won't like lose lots of money, but you won't get all the gains of the star stock in your portfolio. But you got the average performance, and that's not so good. But however, compared to the average returns, average performance, that you got less volatilities. So you reduce your risk a lot. So portfolio is a good way, just like you can have a good sleep because your portfolio is not so risky anymore. But however, the trade-off is just like your performance of your portfolio will be average, will be the average performance. You won't have super good years because what you have is just average of every stock in your portfolio. But you won't just get the really bad luck just because of one stock. It won't drag you down just by one particular stock because you have a portfolio with many stocks. So just like that. You take several classes, right? So your average GPA is just like you have a portfolio. Everything is average out if you have a portfolio. So so basically it's just like that. So you don't want to put all your money into one basket, into one stock. You want to spread it out. So so something happens to one stock and then it doesn't have too much impact to your overall performance. So that's why you want to diversify and you want to have portfolios.
So basically the portfolio way in its security.
Yeah. Let's work on questions number two. So what is portfolio? Why portfolio? What to consider to consider a portfolio? So you want to set up a portfolio, so you don't want to have Apple, Google, and Yahoo, Microsoft, all these high-tech companies like you like in your portfolio. You want to diversify. So what kind of rules you need to set up, you need to consider when you're setting up a portfolio? You need to diversify. So what's the meaning of diversification? It's just like adding stock into your portfolio that's working, or you have to just consider, you have to cross over the industry, right? Cross over the border. Don't focus on one industry. If you do that, do not diversify. So the purpose of diversification is just to reduce your risk. Something happens to the high-tech industry, but however, it's not a significant impact in your overall portfolio. So that's why you want to spread out your risk to as much as you can. So cross over the industry, cross over the borders, invest in other countries. It could be good ways to diversify. Yeah, so the more diversified you are, well, you just get the average. You just get more averaged out. But since you're more of the averaged out, so anything happens in one particular, for one particular reason, it won't change your portfolio's value too much because you're not heavily invested in one area. So you diversify. So that's the reason. Just spread out your investment to as much as you can so you'll be diversified. You give your money to a mutual fund, and because they spread out among like different regions and different securities, like even in the bond market and global bond market, and even foreign currencies or commodities. So it's very diversified. Even commodities, also like gold. You probably don't realize it, that your mutual fund managers put money into the gold as the way to hedge your portfolio, to diversify. So that's why you want to diversify. But however, the thing is just like, if commodity is booming, but you only hold a small percentage of the portfolio. You didn't put everything, because you don't know like it's going to be booming year for commodity. No one knows. So that's why you want to diversify. Let's do the calculation. There are some questions similar in this, in the exam. So For example, so how much is the weight? What percentage you invested in each stop? We got four stops here. So this one is pretty easy. Think about big pie is $1,500. What is the percentage? What is the percentage? Yeah, 2 over 15, 3 over 15, 4 over 15, and 60, 6 over 15. So that's the percentage. Okay, now still using, consider, now you know the returns of the four stops. Yeah, 2 over 15, 3 over 15, 4 over 15, 6 over 15. Okay, so you know the returns of the four stops. So what is your portfolios? What is your portfolios return? What is your portfolios estimation? Why we have to have this estimation? This is like we use it to consider how good students. And then, like I'm showing you, we use it just to figure out the percentage to lose money. This is how much. So,
so here we use the portfolio.
See, the equation is here. This is the equation. When you have a portfolio, W is just a weight. W is the weight. And this is, we got four stops. So W1 times R1 plus W2 times R2. So for this one, so this chapter is all calculations. Okay, so it should be.
So that's the calculation now?
It's all calculation. So it should be 2 over 15. This is the weight. This is portfolios, just weighted average. Since the returns are given,
tails from the book, so I use YouTube.
Yeah.
And normally it'll explain it to me, and then when I read the book, then I understand. But I'm a slow learner.
I don't think I put the questions of portfolios and calculations there, but it's similar. You just replace the probability by the weight, so it's just like. I think there's a question like this. Is it? I don't remember. Should be this. There is should be close to because we got just also use the weight multiplied by the return, individual return minus. Okay.
30 turns before stop sign. They're going to post the formula.
It's similar. I don't think exam questions have something similar to that. Ask you something similar.
If it does that, what do you do? Oh, no one like when it's doing like a railroad tracks, let's say sometimes it'll say number like that or
okay, so So you know the state and probably is 40-60 for boom and bust. And the return is given.
30%.
Yeah. Okay, so what you do in this case, well, it looks like complicated, but however, we got two stocks. Just consider it's one portfolio. So first thing you should do, calculate the portfolio's return and get rid of. You don't need to be bothered by the individual stock anymore. You just use this, the portfolio. So see, the portfolio should be how much? 25 multiplied by 2, so it should be 12.5, right? So the mean of these two, the average of these two, 12.5, this one is 7.5. And so you just use 12.5 and 7.5. This is so instead of Portfolio is what? Portfolio is just like 30% and then so it should be 30% minus 5% divided by 2. This will be a portfolio. Okay, so this one is also negative 10% plus 25% divided by 2. So it's 7.5%. 12.5%. See, and then you, after this, you don't need this number anymore. You don't need these numbers. So you just use 12.5 and 7.5 and do the calculation. And the probability of 40%, 24 and 26. Yeah, and see, so your expected return of this should be 24 multiplied by 12.5% plus 0.6, 7.5%. How much? 9%? 9.5%. And standard deviation will be, since you got 9.5, it should be 4.4. Just consider this as individual stock. That's the variance. This is the variance. And then, and the square root of the variance would be standard deviation. So, if you have questions like this, I don't remember though, you calculate the portfolio's returns first. So, you guys have to do this. You guys give up?
Just the variance.
It's actually pretty easy. You just follow the equation.
And are you going to post these on the website?
The question, the answers?
Yeah.
I can, but I think I can do that. I'll go back and post the answers.
So I can.
So we can work back through the different steps. Yeah.
Study. Yeah. That's the only thing. Like, remember, I was asking a question, and then you told me to read the examples and stuff like
yeah.
that. When I read the examples, boom, I got it right away.
Yeah. It's really not bad. You just have to do that. Yeah. I'll work on it. Yeah.
So the square root of the square root of what the variance is the
The square root of the variance is static image. Anyhow, I can tell you guys are tired of this kind of calculation. We still have a lot to do. We just figured out the return. We have based on that, but we want to know like all the returns so much. Every stock is returned. So how can we do that?
We take like 5 minutes.
See, we have not much. Yeah, I'll post the solutions for doing these questions. And you guys want to take a short break?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Just don't touch this. It's still recording. Be careful what you say.
Are we going on the break?
Yeah, we're on the break.
Three different tools, and I'm using the same figure every 4 days. 24.3, yeah.
I taught her because I did that next problem in the same table.
Yeah.
And project B more, but project
yeah, B. And that's I
think she thinks,
I'm
Which one? Oh, yeah. Stop right there.
Again, digitally. Okay, let's see. That's okay. I got a 98. You got a 98. Okay, this one is. Did you figure out number one and two already? I'm just in the IR for this part. Okay, that one. It's 39.40. Yeah. Let's skip it. Just the fact that I think. Yeah, that's fine. This way. She took to the smart. Left left her husband, went to New Zealand to visit a friend, and then they're going to find out and see her. I haven't seen her in almost 2 years. Oh, she's finishing, she just graduated from her master's.
She just graduated
because and plus part of it is my son-in-law.
Oh, number four. This is number four, right? The one that don't have a number. It doesn't have a number. I know it is. Did you get You're almost done with the test? I need to get this thing done this week because I'm going to be very busy. Yes, you're smart. Like I said, I got a photographic memory, but the lens seems to be so dirty. No, back then, my major was science. And then when I came down here, I went to social science, general science major. Because I want to go back to at least see the nurses. I was a med school doctor, not med school, but pre-med doctor. I was going to be a med doctor like my mom. My sister's a doctor. My sister's in the public place. She has a family. She passed away on my birthday. She was born in my I was so devastated because I was about ready to go to the next. By the time she had a massive So
I'm taking notes.
Is that hard?
Yeah. So far, like I said, if I follow suit on studying them, I get it. But right now, it's like everything's confusing right now. But when I study, I probably get it. It's like the
Okay. Let's continue. You guys are tired. I know the calculation quads really nothing like fun I can share with you guys. Nothing interesting I can share with you guys. I'll show you how to do the calculation. That's all I can do.
And I think if you post the solution, it gives us a chance to like rework them.
I will. I'll get it done either today. either get it done today or tomorrow. Yeah, but let me still go through the questions, because the questions will be similar to those in the exam. So at least you got some idea. Okay, question number five, it's the same thing. See, we got, because now we have to figure out the weight. Weight will be 60% in X and 40% in Z. So you also have to figure out the proportions return. It's about X and Z, and you know 60% is in X and 40% is in Z. So you need to figure out the three states and proportions returns how much, and then do the same thing.
The variance, let me know.
Let's just skip this one. I'll provide you the solution. It's the same kind of idea.
Okay.
Same kind of idea. So it's just like, choose out the portfolio. How do you get the percentage for the portfolio, like for A and B? We just calculated the average for this. Is it going to be equal to times 0.6? For the whole condition, you just use 50% multiplied by 60%. Okay. Plus 10% multiplied by 40%. That will be your proportion return for the boom state. And then you do 10% multiplied by 60% plus 9% multiplied by 40%. That will be your normal. And then you repeat it for the recession. And then you have like three states kind of reach prices. And then you do the same thing. So I'll provide the solution the same thing. Anyhow, so we now know the portfolio. And just assume everybody has diversified portfolio. It's diversified, fully diversified. Then, for example, if you have diversified portfolio, then something happened. It could probably has no impact in your portfolio at all. So if you have diversified portfolio, it means like if you have fully diversified portfolio, just like you have lots of stocks. House region, house security types, house industry. So it's fully diversified. So if you have a fully diversified portfolio, and then you only need to be worried about systematic risk, and you can just ignore the non-systematic risk or unsystematic risk here. So what it is just you have diversified portfolio. You could only just put your focus on the important, significant event. For example, the Fed will increase interest rate in December, in the middle of December. So that's the risk you have to consider, because usually when interest rate goes up, the stock market will fall. Every stock value will drop. Every stock price will fall when Fed increases interest rate. So you just need to be worried about this kind of event, this kind of significant major event, which has a significant impact in the whole market. It's going to have an impact in every stock in the market. You only need to just pay attention to those kind of events or risk, like a Hurricane Matthew or a strike in one city, anti-Trump. And that sort of thing, it's regional, it's only insignificant. Those, you can just ignore those. You don't need to be worrying about this kind of risk. Because you have diversified portfolio, and those risks will not be significant at all. See, Hurricane Matthew only hit Jacksonville, but you have everybody, everything. So it's not significant to your portfolio. So that's the thing, see? So that's called non-systematic risk. If it's regional, if it's related to firm, to a particular firm, or to a particular industry, you don't need to be bothered by that. That's called non-systematic risk. So you only need to be thinking about what is this, what kind of systematic risk or market-wide risk will happen. You just need to focus on the whole market. Let's say the war, the election, the recession, and the interest rate changes. What else? Those major things. Okay, so So what's total risk? The total risk is just like you have everything. You have systematic risk and non-systematic risk. And total risk is just like you consider everything. If you are only buying one stock, and we say we use standard deviation to measure the risk, and that's total risk. But however, if you have portfolio, a lot of the risk, for example, Walmart risk, if you just buy Walmart stock, and the risk is very high, but if Walmart is only 1% in your portfolio, so anything happened to Walmart will not have a significant impact to your portfolio. So you don't need to be bothered by what's happening within Walmart or related to Walmart anymore. That's why. So total risk is just like a lot of them could be gone. If you diversify, you can get rid of a lot of risk related to Walmart. Total risk is just standard deviation. Systematic risk is like not, you cannot diversify this away. This is just because you're investing in the stock market, it's risky. You cannot get rid of the systematic risk. The non-systematic risk is just like regional, related to a firm, to an industry. You don't need to be bothered by that. You have fully diversified portfolio, and this is gone. This part is gone. So this is just theory. You know, I can show you using math to prove this kind of stuff, but we don't have time, so I'll just go quickly for like what it is. So which one is important to your portfolio? Which one? Systematic risk, because you have stock market, so you have the risk, but the risk is just systematic risk. So so non-systematic risk is gone, diversified away. Yeah. Which one should be totally irrelevant? Non-systematic risk should be totally irrelevant because it's non-significant. Because systematic risk is market-wide. It has an impact in everything in your portfolio. The non-systematic risk is only impact a small portion of your portfolio, so it's not significant. That's why. Okay, if so, so we have to just figure out a way to calculate the systematic risk. So total risk, we use standard deviation to do the calculation. For systematic risk, we can use beta to do the calculation.
Beta.
Yeah, I can show you. So there are lots of theoretical studies, papers. I can just give it to you to read, and you can come up with this conclusion. But I'll just tell you, we can use beta to measure the systematic risk. What's beta? So we don't have lots of details. Beta. Yeah, beta measures the, because you see, systematic risk is related to the whole market. So the beta just measures each individual stock's co-movement with the market or correlation with the market. Since we say the whole market is really risky, it's measured by systematic risk, and then so we can use beta. This is correlation of individual stock with the market to measure the systematic risk of each stock. So if we say, well, which stock is risky, you just compare at beta of that stock. The higher the beta, the higher the risk we know it is. So now we're using beta, which is the correlation of stock with the market. Because we can find the beta easily on Google Finance or Yahoo Finance for beta. The higher the beta, the more risky the stock is. How to calculate the beta? So, but it's not required, but the beta is just correlation. The equations for beta I can just introduce to you, but it's not required. The equation for beta is just this, covariance of stock, RM is just market portfolio, the market on average, RM just market. It's just average return of all stocks in the market. And then, so this is beta. This is M stands for market. This is covariance.
Covariance.
Covariance is a constant statistic. So measures commitment of individual stock with the market. So this is how to calculate data. But however, we don't have to do the calculation because the number, the value of data for each stock, you can find it online. It's free.
What's that, the bottom one? The square, the bottom?
Yeah, this is a variance of the market. The variance of the market. But this is where to find it. See it all available. Google Finance, for example, type. I think we did it when we were studying the stock market. Here it is. Beta equals to zero means no risk. Beta is close to zero means pretty small, pretty low risk. Beta equals to what? One, just the average. So beta equals to one, just average of everything. So that's the market beta. The market on average has a beta equals to one. Because remember, beta measures the co-movement. So the market co-moves with itself. So beta equals to one. So when beta is higher than one, that means that stock is riskier than the market. Means if you put money into the stock and you got some performance, could be higher than the average market did. But however, in the bad period, you may lose more money than the market on average. But in good years, you will make more money than the market. For example, Apple, APL here, 1.32. So it's 32% more risky than the market. The market is beta equals to one's market. So Apple is 32% higher, more risky than the market. Its beta is 1.32. So, you know, so that's how you figure out like how risky it is. Using beta. Remember, Walmart is 0.01. It means you buy Walmart stock and you don't have much of the gain. You don't have much of the loss. It just stays there. Yeah. But if you buy Apple, it could be good, it could be bad.
That equals to like almost 32%.
Yeah. Another one is say G is 1.2.
Whoa, that's high.
Let's see.
How about any tech stock?
Yeah.
It's a good tech.
So if you're comparing three of them, you just add them together and divide by three?
And you do have three of them, right? So the portfolios, you do the same, you use the weight, multiply by the beta, and so weighted, it's called weighted average.
So if you have three of them, you add them together and then divide by three?
But no, you have to just consider percentage. You invest in each stock. You have to consider the weight.
Yeah. Yes, thanks for being there.
Anyhow, let's just try another one.
Viewers.
Yay.
What is G omega?
Yay, 1.05. Bank of America.
What?
1.6 or 1.6 for
now. Higher than Walmart.
Yeah, the banking industry is considered more risky.
Yeah, like higher than the Apple stock.
Yeah, it's more risky. It's considered more risky. Okay, so how to calculate the data? So we're here now. Are we okay? Because we went really fast. But if you guys take more advanced, you know, finance class, we go to more details of this kind of topics. But here, all you need to know is like individual stocks. We use standard deviation, and that's called total risk. But you are investors. You're having diversified portfolio. Now we only care about systematic risk, and then we use beta to measure the systematic risk. We can find the beta from many resources like Google or Yahoo Finance. The higher the beta, the more risky the stock is considered. But the beta equals to one, that means it's close to the average performance in the market. Beta equals to zero means it's close to like risk-free kind of the security. So do you want higher beta or lower beta?
Lower
beta, but however, you don't have the gains. Because high risk, high return. It really depends on like your tolerance for risk. You want lower risk means you're conservative, you don't want risk, and that means you give up the possibilities to make money. The high risk, high beta means while it's risky, but however, meanwhile, you got chances to make money. Like Apple, you put money into Apple,
yeah.
You know, you got more chances to make money in the long run.
Yeah, but in the 90s, they were in trouble in the 90s.
Yeah.
Bill Gates bailed them out.
Anyhow, so now let's go back to the questions. See, there are questions in the exam. I remember a few of here. I see, don't say that. But however, I just want to make sure that you understand those questions. Don't say which one is the correct answer, but do you have any problems? You understand what I mean here?
It's not a firm specific risk, unsystematic risk.
It's not. Unsystematic risk is related to like region, particular area, particular industry, particular firm. It's not like the whole market kind of thing.
Risk of firm loss.
Yeah, don't say which one, but you understand this question, right?
So the unsystematic is specific?
Unsystematic is specific to an industry or to a firm or to an area. But systematic is just everybody.
Unsystematic is one firm.
It's pretty easy to see, right?
Which of firms not a systematic risk?
Right, so it's no problem, right? So got it? Yeah. So see, you have that results before those, you don't care what's happening to only like only part of the tutorial myself.
See, like when we get our 401ks, they told us like the higher age you want, you want to take risk because.
Yeah. But however, they also tell you the older you get, and then you should just be more conservative. Don't take risk.
No, they told me they put it like on you know like like you said, you diversify. Yeah. Some of them are high risk, some of them are you know spread it out.
Sometimes those people, they want to charge you because they want you to take, you know, they want to sell to you the one like they charge the most in fees.
I think I lost $20,000 in my 401k.
That's normal.
No. $20,000.
I know. Because you're not retired yet. Yeah.
I mean, but there's also funds that will adjust your target retirement data, and they'll adjust your risk balance as you get closer to retiring.
Yeah.
And you'll start shifting more to bonds, less stocks.
Yeah.
Like Vanguard, you can put one of those funds.
And yeah.
It'll adjust for you as you get older.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. So, but anyhow, just like you're younger and you want more risky kind of stuff, and you're older, you tend to just be more conservative because you might use the money. Yeah, go ahead. Separate what?
For a 401k, it's building your retirement. And so in the US, say I work for Wells Fargo Bank, and they'll take money off of my paycheck, like a percentage, and put it into that account, and it will be a mix of stocks, bonds, and they'll accrue interest. Sometimes the employer will match that money. So like if you put 3% pay in there, they'll be matched 2%. So then you have 6% going and it's pre-tax. So it actually lowers your taxable income when you get ready for
retirement.
Or when you go to your taxes, it lowers how much you have. So is the stocks that the company has are those stocks your choice or not your choice? It depends. Sometimes you can quit funding the phone. And sometimes they have a fund manager that sets up a portfolio or a mix of stocks on. Or a lot of companies don't manage things directly. They have a provider. Like I worked here
they probably should. But we partner with either Vangelic or CIAA, and they manage what goes where. It's not like JU is picking.
NCOM, this is the model, it's called capital model. C stands for capital, A stands for asset, P stands for pricing, M is model. So it's capital asset pricing model. This is a very fundamental one. Many firms are still using this model to get a return. Because you see, only one factor in this model, which is beta. You know the beta, and then all the other factors, all the other variables are given, should be known. Like this is the return, like Apple's return. E stands for expected return for Apple, equals to this is RF. F stands for risk-free rate, which is like when beta equals to zero, this how much is the return? This is like a 3 months treasury bill rate or the bank's rate for short-term saving. And that's the RF, which is like no risk at all. The return is how much. And this is RM. E stands for expected. So what's your expected returns from your market portfolio? Or the average return of the market is how much? That's here. So plug into this model, get the returns from Apple.
Yeah.
It's called CAPM model.
That's not.
Once you know the beta, plug in, got the return. So for example, if you got 10% of return, that means you put money into Apple, you get 10% of return. So if you put down $1,000, at the end of the year, you should get $1,100, 10% of returns from Apple. So just this sort of thing, using this model. That's what we all want to know. We want to know, like, putting money into Apple, what kind of returns you can get. You know, so finally, we come up with this kind of solutions to get it.
So can you do one for us? Like an example of one?
Yeah. for example, you see, this is just to demonstrate this equation. Yeah, let me just show you this graph. This is called security market line. You see, this is mathematical equations that you show that in the graph. You see, it's just like this. The x-axis, this is just beta. This is different beta, like beta, Apple is here, 1.3 something. So it's the return should be somewhere here. And then Bank of America is 1.6, so it should be here. Okay. And then Walmart is close to zero, so the return is low. And this point is when beta equals to zero. This is like bank saving rate or 3 months credit bill rate. So this beta equals to zero, this is just average of the market. Beta equals to zero, equals to one. This is just average market portfolio or average performance of the market. Usually we use S&P 500 as a proxy for that. Because S&P 500 has 500 stocks. And see, this is the intercept. This is a straight line. This is a linear equation, right? So this is intercept. Intercept is just risk-free rate. The slope is that part. Rise over run. Run equals to one. Rise equals to market return minus the risk-free rate. This is called market risk premium. Market risk premium. So the slope is this part, which is market risk premium. The intercept is beta. Once we know the intercept and the slope, we can draw this line. We can draw this line. So this line is just called security market line. That's
the one.
That's here. So this is a nice pattern model to show that in your graph. Yeah, and then now let's just apply those numbers to do some studies here. Okay, so this is the above, this is security market line. What's intercept? Here, right? This is 8%. Here, intercept. What's the slope? When beta equals to one, that's 15%, minus is like 8%, minus 8%, so it's like 7%, right? That's a slope. Yeah. When beta equals to one, which portfolio is it? It's a market, right? It's a market portfolio. It's called market portfolio. Market portfolio is just everything, including security, commodity, currency, bond, everything. Property, real estate, everything. But depending on this, beta equals to zero, which portfolio? 3 months tracking bill rate or saving rate. Where's Apple? You know, where's Google? Where's Walmart? Where's S&P 500? S&P 500 is saving equals to what? Here. Apple is somewhere here.
1.32.
Safer. Should be somewhere here. Walmart is here.
Very safe.
You know, Bank of America.
1.6.
Here. And then let's just use this model to do the calculation like a 12. This seems to be the last question. This is a model. You see, the beta is given, plug into here. You see the risk-free rate. Sometimes it doesn't say risk-free rate. I think in the exam it said 3 months treasury bill rate or something. It's 35, right? 35, yeah. See, the 3 months treasury bill rate, this is the risk-free rate. S&P 500, this is the market return, market rate. So this is RF, this is RF. Plug into the model. And then you use the beta you calculated from here. Use this data and plug into type of model we get before this week.
Which one was our
market?
This market.
The market, yeah. S&P 500 index, you can use this to as a proxy for RM.
So what's the
model again? Which one?
The formula
for this one? The
capital. Just this one, capital model. See, in that case, this is 2%, so this is 10%. The sign, the beta from the previous question.
So what's E?
E is, you can just ignore E. E means expected.
Oh, okay.
It's finance, is like we want to know expected returns how much, so E just expected. Just means expected. You can just remove E, it won't change.
The beta.
I say in this case, like this company should be 4.15% plus 2.685 multiplied by, you see, this is market risk premium. You can just use it directly. This market risk premium, just the difference between the two already. Don't pick it up one more time. You see, so the answer for this one should be 2.65. Yeah. And so the DCLK should be equal to 4.15% plus 8.5%. So 8.5% is not the market return. So it's a difference. It's the return for market beyond the risk-free rate. It's called market risk premium. So that's this one. So watch out for the definition for the word. It's market risk premium, you use that number directly. Don't subtract. Okay. So I'll provide the solutions to this. So why we're using beta? Just assume like these are just four stocks, like you got other stuff in the two. So if you only have those four stocks, nothing else. So you have to consider portfolio standard deviation because it's not diversified. But since you know everybody has mutual funds, everybody has like they're diversified. So if you just put 1% of your money in Apple. And then so you have very diversified portfolio, so you want to know the returns of Apple, use this model, use capital model. But if you have only Apple, nothing else, so you should just consider the total risk, the standard deviation of Apple, because that's the only thing you have. But since this is not the case, right, so we're using beta, in this case. See, so we will have another class. We will just do the financial statement stuff, and then I'll answer the questions. So you can, if you are working on the exam, you have any questions, send me an email or bring it to class next time. Yeah, I'm pretty sure like for you guys can, I cannot guarantee you all get A, but you all can get pass or fail, you can all get passed. So
I'm not pass fail, I'm the A.
Me too.
Yeah.
I have to bring my thing up.
Probably all of you guys are like, when the other pass or fail, they just don't care that much. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, yeah, one more
thing. But you did say the top 10 people are getting A, so didn't you?
Okay, yeah, yeah. Okay, guys, I need you guys to do this. This is just college.
We're not, it's not going to be the computer, man.
It's a computer. The computer is, but you still have to put the comments. They give it to you. But because you still, the computer, you don't have to put the comments. I don't know.
No, you do. You do.
You do? But I don't know why this one. This one.
You want us to fill that out?
I think so. And also, you have to bring it to the graduate office for you.
Now?
No, when is that? When is that?
Next week.
When? No, when is that? Yeah, you have to do that now.
Okay.
And I'll come back and then take this.
I'll take it to your office?
No, don't give it to me.
I mean, where do I want, where I take it?
Yeah.